In this video, we're going to finish 10.3. We're going to continue simplifying radical expressions. So on the first part, we dealt with the product rule and the quotient rule. You will use both of those ideas for the remaining problems. So in the rest of the problems, directions will say simplify completely. So in this box, you'll see, look for factors of the radicand that are perfect square factors. We want to rewrite the radicand as a product of its largest perfect square. That's a really important word. Sometimes she likes to do it to where she breaks it down to its primes and then looks for pairs and so forth. And that's an okay method. I just think that it's easier to get confused with that. So remember how we wrote down these perfect squares? This box is so important for this section. So I again would really, really urge you to have these written down. So what I've done here is written on the very top of the page the first 12 perfect squares, just so we can use them as a reference as we do these problems. So you're going to see me scrolling backwards and forwards. But again, the things you need to make sure that you're not breaking at the end of the problem is there can be no perfect square factors left underneath the radical. Okay. So I'm going to even add that. And in the final solution, you cannot have any radicals in the denominator. Throughout when you're finished with the problem. So what we want to do is, I think part of the problem in the very beginning is that y'all are looking for just factors, two numbers that multiply to give you the number underneath the radical. But what I need you to ask yourself is in that radicand, which is what's underneath, look for the biggest perfect square that divides into it. So some of you will see these really quickly. Some of you will need to look at this list on the top. And if you're looking at the list on the top, go up to the number that's the smallest number that's possible, and then just go down. So looking at our list, in this case, 4 is a perfect square. And 4 times 6 gives me 24. Now, I tend to do it the way I'm just showing you right now. I actually circle the perfect square so that I know that that's the square root I'm taking, and what's not circled stays underneath. Because what I do find is y'all tend to get confused on what's staying and what's going. But I want to show you truly why it is. Really, you're using the product rule so we can break that factorization into two different pieces. And then this square root of 4 gives me the 2. And that's why it's still a product, because we truly are using the product rule to get this answer. So going to number 11, I want you to stop and think about it. What is the perfect square that goes into 32? Big trap here. If y'all paused it, I would like you to. Most of y'all will say 4. But 4 is not the biggest perfect square, the largest perfect square. This is where you got to be careful, especially with the number 4. Always double check if 16 goes into it. That's probably one of the most common ones we miss. But always look for that number that's below it. And 25 doesn't work, then 16 does. Okay. So this would be 16 times 2, square root of 16, 4 comes out, and again, we leave it as a product. If you need to see that extra step, break it into its product using our product rule for radicals, and that's where that 4 comes out. I don't mind you showing just the green step, just be careful. Make sure you're clear on what's staying underneath the radical and what is going outside of the radical. So again, at each one of these problems, good idea for you to start pausing, see if you know how to do it without me doing it, and then press play and see if it matches. So square root of 45, we're looking at our list of perfect squares, and perfect square that goes into it is 9 times 5. Square root of 9 gives me 3 radical 5. Again, I'm going to add that optional step on the bottom that would give you that answer. Number 13. 13 is one that's super easy to get kind of hung up on. You'd like immediately want to jump and say, oh, 30 times 10 or something like that. But remember, we're looking for a perfect square that's a factor. So we're looking through our list. And Again, I haven't listed higher ones in this, but 300 with the list I'm going, if you start on the top, you should see that we should be able to use 3 times 100. And you notice that I wrote it, I didn't write my perfect square first. I want you to realize that's okay, because when we pull a perfect square out, that goes in the front of the radical. Again, really truly what I did was use that product rule to pull that piece out. But when we pull a perfect square out, and essentially what we're doing is simplifying the square root, that is a product that's really important. You're going to keep hearing me use that terminology. Looking at number 14 and 15, go ahead and pause and see if you can do both of those. So press pause now. See if you can think your way through those two. Square root of 10. There is no perfect squares in this one. That is simplified. So remember, they like to throw these at you every once in a while in your homework because it's generating the computer. But I do want to stress that on the test, you will not have any that something is not able to be done to it. Going to number 15, that's an easy one again to fall into the trap of seeing 48 is 4 goes into it. You go 4 and 12. It still works if you do it that way, but remember to look for the biggest perfect square. So when we're looking at our list, 16 works on this one. And also remember, we're going to circle that negative, because that's negative 1 and that's going to stay. So I have 16 times 3, which gives me a negative 4 radical 3. That negative stays on the outside. Now, I'm going to quickly just show you here, if you had done it the other way, which I don't recommend, but say you did 4 times 12. So then you get a negative 2 radical 12. 12 still has a 4 in it, so a negative 2, 4 times 3. Remember, it's a product when you pull it out. So that's a mistake people make, is that when they pull out, they think they're adding. We're using the product rule, so you need to make sure you do that. So I want you to see, I'm never going to mark you wrong if you did the problem like I did in blue, but you want to look for the shortest way to do it so that you make less mistakes. So really recommend list those perfect squares on the top of your paper when you're testing and you're quizzing. Right? Keep writing them down to where they're automatic, and it will help you out. 16, 17, 18 on my page here. And so remember, in the last video, talked about taking the square root of variables as well. And remember that you're looking for pairs of them. And also, just a quick reminder, and so I'm going to write this up above it, that if you have the square root of something, remember that's the same thing as dealing with x to the half power. So it's essentially dividing the exponent by 2. So that was reviewed in the first part of the videos for 10.3. So on this problem here, I still though think y'all are going to do better if you break it up into perfect squares and what's left over. Think about it in what's left over. Don't just do it in your head. So 16 is a perfect square. That 4 comes out. 2 goes into M one time, so 1 comes out, and there's 1 left over. So if there's an odd exponent, you're always going to have 1 left over when you're taking the square root, because we're looking for pairs. Remember, that's the same thing as taking the half power, so that's why we're looking for pairs. This is my answer. Going to number 17. Again, pause this at any time. I really think it's valuable for y'all to try to do it first, and then if you're stuck, press play. So I'm going to break it up into factors, leaving one of them being a perfect square. So for 200, it'd be 100 times 2. So that's a perfect square. The k's, I have k to the sixth and a k left over. And the q's are an even power, so all of them are going to come out. So that means a 10 comes out from that. 6 divided by 2 gives me 3 pairs. 8 divided by 2 gives me 4 pairs. And by circling them, what I like about this is it's super clear what's left over. What I didn't circle stays underneath. She's going to again show it to where she's going to break them into two separate radicals and then using the product rule. Totally fine. You can do that extra step, but this is kind of a way to visualize it as well with circling those perfect squares. So last one, number 18, square root of 25 p to the 7th. So I'm going to rewrite it. 25 is a perfect square. P to the 7th is p to the 6th times p. So now I can pull out a 5 from the 25. And there are three pairs because 6 divided by 3, or sorry, 6 divided by 2 is 3. And the p is left over. It was not circled. If it helps to use different colors, if it helps to highlight, use whatever you need to. But all of your rules still apply. If it's a negative outside the radical, circle it, make sure you keep it. Whatever format you decide to use, please be careful. You're using the product rule. What comes out, what stays.